Welcome to Soul Night Live, episode number 96. Tonight, our guests are Derek and Noah Shulman.
Hi, Sean. How are you?
Not bad, you know. It feels like things are sort of getting back to normal here in Atlanta. In some ways, it seems like it was all just a bad dream, you know. How about for you up there in New York?
Actually, New York is becoming, back to sort of semi-normal. It's people are going out and enjoying restaurants and bars the city is getting busy again. Obviously, shows are not happening right now, but they apparently will go live in the end of June or the end of this month and the beginning of July. So that's the good news here.
So how have you been spending your days in the past few months?
Well, actually, things are becoming a little more normal. I'm involved in several things, not just Gentle Giant. I'm involved with other things that I do outside of being an ex-musician, if you like, or a musician that only plays at home. So I'm involved in a couple of interesting projects which are related to the business, but not related. But focusing on getting this new record out, the new old record, should I say, freehand, and working with the band and my son, who's becoming a quasi-manager,
yes,
and taskmaster, to say the least. things are getting back, which I'm happy about because I'm not very good at twiddling my thumbs or fingers or whatever. So. The business and the music world and music generally is coming back. So it's a little less boring, a little less depressing, and thankfully this whole year and a quarter seems like it's going to be over in a very short period of time.
Well, fingers crossed.
Right. Yeah, absolutely, because it's been awful, not just for us. For everyone, and I know that everyone is dying to get out there. Not least of which are the musicians and the bands and the working artists that you are used to just to make a living. So most of those, some of the bands that I've been involved in, and literally had to go home to their parents and live off their parents' money, or not even or the girlfriends, or God knows what else. So, that's really just being in touch and starting to start planning again as of now.
Yeah. Well, I'm hopeful. It feels like we're on there's light at the end of the tunnel and we're almost out of it. So
that's and just as a reference point, the good news is that I'm able to meet people in person rather than Zooming, which of course we have to do because we're about 1,000 miles apart. But it's good to see friends, family, of course, and people that are in the same business, and we can get together and talk music or talk about plans, etc. So that's another notch on the way back to normality.
Sure. Well, it seems like Gentle Giant's profile has been on the rise in the past year with these reissues and such, and a resurgence of interest,
and
then the t-shirts.
You have one of those.
Oh yeah, I think it was when Noah was on last time.
Yes,
it's like yes, I want one of those, and
yes, yes, one. Indeed, so, I think you are probably the instigator of us putting that together. Actually, there's a. As a sort of
that's awesome. Well, good. I'm glad I can inspire, because I just personally wanted one, but I also knew that thousands of my friends would love one too if it was possible. So, and now they have them.
We have a new line of clothing, if you like, for freehand.
I like it. We're going to talk about that here in a minute. I'm going to bring in Noah, I guess, here in a couple minutes, and I thought we would play the same video and let him do like a play by play over the top of it. About how it was put together, and I really like it. You know what it kind of reminds me of is those cartoons that Monty Python had. You remember how it was always
Yeah, you know what? He had no idea. You know, yeah, I mean, Monty Python was before his time.
Yeah.
In my time, of course, but yeah, it's very, very early 70s British, you know, sort of illustrations of silly things.
Yeah, very much.
Which is what Gentle Giant was about, of course.
Musically, yes.
Musically, you know, illustrations of silly things.
Well, I really like the style of the video. It has that kind of, you know, almost like every object was on a piece of paper and cut out, you know, with scissors and pasted on there. And that's a really interesting effect. I like that.
Yeah. If you look at it actually very closely, there are tons of what is called Easter eggs. Right? I won't get into that because that's his thing, not
mine. But just little visual cues that'll remind us of Gentle Giant history.
Exactly that, right.
Okay, well, good. I think people should keep an eye out. We don't necessarily want to give them all away now.
No. But, I've only seen them a couple of times.
Let's at least make people aware of them so they can kind of guess them on their own. Yeah, sure. So we got a lot of folks in the chat room. Everybody's saying hi.
Hi, guys. See here. And girls.
You made some good records. Indeed, you did. Oh, it looks like Richard Sinclair's watching. Hi, Richard. How are you? Good to see
you. Hey, how are you?
Who has another question? Laura would like to know, Derek, are you doing any work with Yes these days? Well, you kind of know Billy Sherwood. So
I know Billy and I know all the band, of course, very, very well. And I'm overseeing some things. Obviously, they're not touring until next year. Yes. But, you know, Billy and the whole band, in a strange way, this is kind of a bizarre situation. I've worked with Yes in about four incarnations. Firstly, as a musician on tour with Yes. And then when I went to the dark side of the business, if you like, became Darth Vader, I had to work with Yes because they were part of my repertoire. And I had to, unfortunately, drop them. Oh. Seriously, because they were spending so much money, we couldn't afford to.
What year was that?
1990 something, World War II. And they went to Arista. You know, and in fact, I introduced Billy to Chris, because you know, it was all over the place then. Anyway, so I've remained friends with you know the guys for decades. So I'm doing bits and pieces, you know, as well as the ex members like Patrick
Were you around in that period when Anderson went to play with Anderson, Bruford, Wakeman and Howe, and they were thinking about rebooting Yes with Billy as the front man?
Correct. That's right. Correct. And Trevor came in and in fact, you know, I've got a video of Trevor Rabin coming to my office and talking about what Yes was about. Anyway. Yeah, so I am kind of overseeing things, and in fact, I'm going to be in touch with Billy this week, and John. So,
yeah, and you had a little hand in that Arc of Life album that he made too, as well. Am I right? Were you kind of his counsel for that? Is that a good way?
That was that was a couple of years ago, and I was kind of overseeing it, but I wasn't like on top of him doing it or sure. as it were. I mean, had I been on top of it doing it, it would have been. It would have been stellar. It's good. It's a good record, man. But you know, no. I was working with him, and happy to, you know, lend a hand whenever I was asked, if you like.
Sure. Well, that was an interesting record. I had them on, I don't know, 3 or 4 months ago. It was a fun chat.
So, yeah. No, they're great guys.
Yeah, and we're excited to hear that new Yes album. It sounds like it's in the can, more or less. Have you heard any of it, just on the side?
Some, yeah.
Okay. It's, well, I hope. I hope it. Compels and astounds like a good Yes album should.
Yeah, exactly that. I hope it does too.
Yeah, so fingers crossed. All right, well, let's bring in Noah and see how he's been doing. Good evening.
Hey, how's it going?
That's a good looking shirt you got there.
Oh yeah. You know, I feel like every time we're on an episode, a new shirt's gonna come out. I don't know. Don't do too many.
Yeah, let's just make it a thing, you know. And I'll get every time I get the last one, you get the new one.
The day, you know, they released yesterday. So but yeah, this is the shirt. This is the long sleeve shirt. I love it. I think it's cool.
I really like the acid wash shirt that you chose to put that on. I think it goes really well with the artwork.
Yeah, yeah. It was totally, you know, like the artwork of Freehand always stood out to me just like over the last, you know, 30 plus years, just very bold. And I always love the colors of the black, white, and red is very bold. And like the palm print was always something that stuck with me. And I always thought of like, how can we replicate that? But like as the texture of the t-shirt. Yeah. So that was the kind of inspiration for that. And then we basically kind of rejiggered and recreated all the graphics from the original, the original artwork, to create something kind of fresh and new, but also, you know, resembles the iconic imagery. So.
Well, I think you hit the bullseye because, you know, those are really nice. That's what they call fashion shirts. I was actually in the, screen printing business for many years. And,
oh, cool.
You know, these thinner, softer shirts are really in, you know, so I think
that's a
great choice to use.
And yeah, yeah.
Good. So folks, check it out. The website is gentlegiantband.com. That's right. Yeah, swing over. And as a matter of fact, let me do a quick screen share and just let people have a closer look at both of those real quick. Here we go. Can you see that?
Work.
There we go. Yeah. So you can see it has this kind of faded look going on there that is what they call acid washed, I think, or
mineral wash is another term, early 20s.
When I was in my early 20s, the stonewash thing, the jeans were, you know, they're a relic of the 80s now, but on a shirt, that's a different ball game. It's fresh and kind of cool looking. So yeah, folks, and check one out. All the cool kids are wearing them.
And we're slowly and also thinking of new items and future to tie to future releases of remixes, and so definitely look out for that. But we're a small shop, so doing the best we can.
Do you still have these available too, or was they
time
thing? Okay,
those are still available. Yeah.
Okay, that's great. Well, those look like they just took off like hotcakes, because let's
say
to see my friends all over Facebook wearing them, and I'm like.
And then we released the keychain and winter hat, which at this point is probably too hot to wear, but so just, you know, there's so many kind of just bold and iconic imagery that I feel like could really, you know, great shirts, great hoodies, all that kind of stuff. We're just going a step at a time, so
you guys should totally be on the forefront of this, because if you search around the internet, there's a lot of people selling Gentle Giant shirts that have nothing to do with you guys. And
and that's one thing I think is really important for the fans and everyone to know, is this is from the band. So like the band, you know, this isn't a third party. This is for and from the band. I'm just the kind of creative person to help kind of put the pieces together, but it's the whatever proceeds or anything of that aspect, it goes to the band. So I just want to make that clear. And I know, I've seen there's many, many knockoff sites, and
have you seen like on Facebook, they'll like screen print Roger Waters' face and stick it on somebody's body and holding up a shirt that costs $50 and it has nothing to do with them or any artist, Paul McCartney, you name it, you know? And it's just like, and I hit that report button every time I see one of those, like, you bastards, you have no right to do this.
But no, it's been really fun. And you know, the response on the first shirt and certainly this one, you know, once it gets in people's mailboxes has been, it's been really great to see people are responding positively to it. So, yeah.
Now the remix, the Stephen Masters Wilson remaster remix, both. Is this out now, or is it coming in the next few weeks?
I answered this one right. it's being released on June 25th, and on Blu-ray, Atmos, regular CD, well, we had red vinyl, but it sold out in 2 days. Literally, it was a limited edition. So we still have vinyl available, but we were going to repress in a different colored vinyl in a couple of weeks or several weeks, because it's a long it takes a while for vinyl to be pressed these days. A long time, actually. It's very bizarre. The vinyl has become incredibly popular again after being dropped by record labels and everyone else, and no one had turntables for like 20, 30 years. And now turntables and vinyl are being like bought by millions of people again, which is very interesting.
Cool. I love it. It just takes me back. You know, I'm pretty much exclusively vinyl. And am I right that basically most of the plants that made them closed and there just aren't a bunch now? So the demand is ridiculously high. I'm surprised they aren't building a couple new plants, you know?
Well, they are actually. I think there's a couple of companies that are building plants. We had to go to, in fact, our distributor has to go to Lithuania I mean, if you'll see, you could see sort of Lithuanian print on in Gentle Giant in Lithuanian.
You should do another colored one. You should do a limited edition black one.
there is a black one as well. Okay, I mean, they're available still.
Yeah. Or yeah, kind of a cloudy gray kind of swirl. I've seen some like that. That might look good with that art. Yeah.
That's exactly what we're doing.
Okay. Excellent. I got to get my hands on one of those. I don't want to miss out this time. So, yeah.
Well, so anyway, it's being released officially on the 25th. And, hopefully people will enjoy it. I mean, I think it's a really well done remix. Stephen's done a great job.
Yeah.
And
I was talking before we logged on here, my friend Anthony Garone had you guys on a couple days ago on his Make Weird Music channel, and he did a great comparison kind of side by side where he plays you like 5 seconds of the old one and then the new one. Great way to get a handle on just how much cooler this new version is. So I suggest people go over and check that out as a nice companion to this episode. Definitely, and John's on there and Ray as well. So, and Mike Keneally, our good friend. So yeah, you can't go wrong. Definitely watch that after this. It's a good one.
Yeah.
So you have made an amazing video for Just the Same. And I was telling your dad, it reminds me a bit of the cartoons on an old show called Monty Python.
Yes.
It was a little before your time, but I bet you probably caught some on YouTube or whatever.
Yeah.
They always had like maybe 5 minutes of cartoons, and it was always this kind of almost like cut out paper shapes pasted on, almost like South Park, but better looking art.
Yeah.
Not quite as crude. And this video has a bit of that look. And I imagine it's all done, via computer nowadays and all that jazz. So I was wondering if you could tell us a bit about like the software that you used to create this in and what your initial inspiration was.
Yeah. I mean, I think, I think the initial inspiration definitely obviously came from just the album and just, it was really like I know this sounds so detailed, but like the contrast of the hand and like how the hand was, it was probably from whatever effect they may have put on it back in 75, just had that kind of very halftone kind of newspaper cutout vibe. It has a little bit of that. So it was definitely inspired by like 70s. I use a lot of public domain, Creative Commons, archival, clippings and stuff like that. But yeah, it was definitely 70s era visuals. And it was also, I'll take the subconscious credit of Terry Gilliam, because I, in full transparency, I'm not like a huge Monty Python fan, or maybe I will be after this, But the initial inspiration, funny enough, was from two music videos. One was, funny enough, a Michael Jackson music video called Leave Me Alone.
Sure.
And it's very much like he's going through this kind of roller coaster where there's cutout videos and different textures. And then the other one is Peter Gabriel's Sledgehammer as well, which has this kind of just really whimsical, over-the-top visuals. There definitely isn't really like a linear storyline. It was much more frankly improvised. I really just kind of made up each scene as I was going. So I mainly use, I think this one was strictly all in After Effects. So it was Adobe After Effects, which I use all the time. And it's very much like I think what the technical term is it's 2.5D. It's not 3D, it's not 2D. It's 2D flat images in a 3D space. So there's a little bit of parallax happening, and it feels more, a little bit more immersive than just like a flat, you know, a flat surface. I really wanted it to be less of a linear storyline and just more of like a kind of a fun, whimsical, colorful, you know, animation where like the music is really at the forefront, but the visuals are, you don't have to really pay attention to like, oh, what's happening in the next scene with, you know? I was just kind of improvising, to be really honest. So
now, does that software isolate these elements and pick out the backgrounds, or is that something you do beforehand and then load all of these into it?
Yeah. So that's, if they're not already cut out, you have to cut them out in Photoshop. And then stock images didn't really have the texture that I wanted. So I actually have a few kind of, I don't know what they're considered, like they're kind of a plugin that creates like a halftone printed effect on top of the image to make it look a little bit, you know, dated, if you will. So, like that. And then in addition to that, which obviously hasn't been released yet, is, you know, I really, for this record, I really took a lot of time to create custom visuals for each track. And I actually brought on a few animators that I work with who have their own style to kind of just let them go off and be like, hey, like, you know, give them the creative freedom within the confines of the gentle giant world to make some really cool visuals. And there's at least, I think, four other artists that did visuals on this, on the Blu-ray. They're very much visual. I don't want to call it a visualizer, and I don't want to call it a music video. It's sort of like an in-between where it's just a really cool visual to have on your screen while you're listening to the record. So I'm really excited to for people to see those as well.
Excellent. Well, yeah. Why don't you say we go ahead and roll it with the sound about down halfway so you can kind of give us a play-by-play. And if there's anything you want me to pause, just holler and I will do that real quick.
All right. I don't know how much I'll give, but let's see.
Fine.
Let's
see what happens. We want to point out that there are historical Easter eggs all thrown through this video, but we're not going to tell you what they all are.
Okay, I'll give a few.
We might clue you to a couple of them to kind of get you primed and ready. But yeah, there's lots of them in there. And that's probably half the fun of watching the vid.
Yeah,
especially
for sure.
If you know your gentle giant history. All right, let's see here. I think this is the one I need. Here we go. Okay, can you see that?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yep.
So I always thought this was actually cool to visually see the snapping that we've always heard, you know, this part.
I like the teeth. They remind me of Uncle Meat from Frank Zappa.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think this is probably the most linear part of the story where it's like we're going into this world, we're going into this movie, basically. This little guy here that's hanging makes a few appearances too. So this part is very much like the hands are kind of going through a factory and being stamped one by one into the albums, just the same.
Thank you.
to this last shot, if you look all the way in the top left, the familiar face on the top left there.
A lot of these like stock photos of life in the 50s and such.
So a shot of Ray in school. I think this part was probably the kind of funnest part to animate, just because it's so, the beat just, the vibe just completely changes here, you know?
Yeah.
And I really wanted like the hand, you can see that's, you'll see in the next scene. I think this probably feels pretty Monty Python-y.
Yeah, I was thinking that, yeah.
So yeah, like the hand, you know, we kind of just now follow the hand through these just weird scenarios. There's that guy hanging off a balloon again. Makes a few appearances. Was fun. Works a lot with the waveforms kind of being part of the design.
And I like the mini boot.
Yeah, that's right. So fun to animate too. It's just all over the place. Phone, there's a few stickers. Some are from Gary's scrapbooks are in there too. They were scanned and cut out. Like a mixture of a tour bus with like toy wheels from some car I found. Just wanted to have fun with it, you know?
Well, that flew by quickly.
Yeah. So, but yeah, it's really like, you can see like I love the like the textures, the palm print textures. I think it really just kind of started from that in the hand. And I just kind of went off and built a whole thing around it. So yeah, it was really fun. It was really fun. And I'm excited for everyone to see the, you know, obviously the music first and foremost, but I think the visuals were really fun, kind of a fun little addition. And I hope to, you know, for any of the future releases, we'll do more of those. And so, yeah.
So is Freehand your favorite Gentle Giant album?
Mine?
Yeah.
Oh man, that's a tough one. It's up there for sure. That I think Octopus, Playing the Fool. I don't know if that's considered an album, but it just captures the live aspect of the band, which is a whole other conversation. But
let me just jump in here very, very briefly, because I know you're speaking to Noah, but Noah, since he was born, and he was born after the band broke up, has been nagging me, putting the band together back and go on tour again. And I said, no, the next best thing is you get involved and you do your thing. And I'm very proud of Noah in doing what he's doing, both visually for the band and actually taking, doing what he does on the social media world and presenting the band to a brand new audience. And that's fantastic. I mean, that's something that I never thought would happen after 40 plus years. So continue to speak to Noah, because I'm just listening here.
Well,
okay. Yeah, I think that's...
I tip my hat to you.
That's definitely been the... Yeah, I agree. I feel like, for years before I even really just started doing more of this stuff, like I would always search on YouTube or, just to see, there was always someone posting a video of them playing or a choir in Germany doing it for their school. And I'm with you. I feel like there's actually been more and more in the last 2 years even. And they're younger and they're more diverse and they're all around the world. And there's an audience and, I think there's just so many stories and so many ways to make content around, a band that was together for a decade. And it's just how you can just recreate those stories in new ways and get new audiences. And it's been really fun. It's been really cool. And it seems like, people really, especially the Proclamation video that we did, people really seem to connect and enjoy that, oh, you're out there too. That's awesome. Let's all connect. And even a lot of the people in that video, went off and connected personally with each other too. So it's been really kind of cool to see that happen.
Yeah. Well, I think your videos have kind of connected to a new audience. And I just feel like, Gentle Giant's profile is a lot higher thanks to your efforts, even more so than some of your peers that are still kicking.
Well, that means a lot. I mean, it's certainly not about me. It's about the band. So whatever I can do to help, that's I think it's an important thing to keep the legacy of the Giant alive,
Absolutely.
Because I said, every time Noah would ask, you guys should get together again. Come on, go on stage. I'd say, Noah, it's not going to happen. Come on. So in the last few years, he's been doing it his own way and becoming the manager of the band, effectively.
I love it.
Oh, boy.
A lot of responsibility.
Yeah, you had told me in our last show, and I should mention that, Derek was a guest and Noah last year, and we did a very extensive Gentle Giant related show that answered pretty much every question you could ever think of. So I'm not going to dig into any of that tonight, but I will put a link right here for you to click and watch that later if you like, because that's a good one. Definitely, that was a lot of questions that fans sent in as well, so we were all over the place. But tonight I'm going to focus just on Freehand mostly, and then I'd love to talk a bit about the early days in London and the music scene when you were,
by all means.
Yeah, I'm always captivated by those stories, so I'd love to hear some of yours. And I'd like to hear about some shows that you've gone to. It seems like anybody that remembers seeing Gentle Giant remembers it as one of their favorite concert memories. I'm curious, what are a few of yours, Derek, some people that you've seen that you look back on finally and just go, God, I'm so glad I went to that show. That was amazing.
Wow, that's a good question. A very good question, actually. Okay, when I was a kid, and we're talking about a long, 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 long time ago, the first time the Beatles tour, I lived in Portsmouth, England, which is, it's about 60 miles south of London. And I saw the first Beatles tour I literally took off school. I faked a note to my teacher, to my headmaster. I was at grammar school then. And I heard Love Me Do on the radio and I thought, what is this? I mean, I was 15, God knows what age I was. And I got in line. And I was literally about third in line to see the Beatles' first concert tour of the UK. And that was first of all, it was unbelievable to see them because they were, they were playing music that no one had heard before. It wasn't like a silly pop stuff that was going on at the time. But a quick sidebar on that story was that Beatlemania had just started. I mean, it was just, I think Love Me Do was the first record, and then She Loves You was next, the next single. Little did I know that the Southern TV cameras were out taking a picture of the line to see the band. And the day before, I had given my teacher a note saying, or the day after, or whatever it was, saying I was sick with a cold, so I couldn't come in. So therefore I wasn't at school. And on the news that evening, they showed the line. And who was in front of the line? Me, on TV. And of course the headmaster saw and the teacher saw, and brought me into the headmaster's room and said, "Shulman, you're going to get two of the best." And I got whacked on the ass two times with a cane. So the good news is I saw the Beatles. The bad news is I got whacked on the ass of seeing them. So that was a show that changed. That was a band that changed everything.
Sure.
I saw the Stones on their first tour, and that was amazing too. I mean, with Brian Jones on his Green Gretsch, you know, man, that was like, okay, that's real. And then when we toured, I mean, this, I could go back even before Gentle Giant, some of the bands that we toured with or I saw. But one of the funniest tours we did, and one of the best stories, and I'm sure it's been told 100 times, so I don't want to retell something which is a kind of redundant, is touring with Black Sabbath. Because they were hilariously screwed up and
you want to hear something funny? I had Phil Manzanera on a couple of weeks ago, and Roxy toured with Black Sabbath as well and went over about as well with their crowd as you guys did.
Actually, honestly, we actually did pretty well, believe it or not. I mean, we were pretty adept at knowing a crowd and having done it prior to Gentle Giant, knowing a crowd and how a crowd would react and tuning our set to something that made a difference to whoever it was. But boy, the Hollywood Bowl show was a hell on earth.
That was the exception.
That was definitely, yeah. And just about every band we toured with, whether it was either as a support or as a support to us, were great, except for the Eagles, complete assholes. I mean, we're talking about assholes backstage, on stage. You know, they were really like, you know, really not nice people, and that's unusual when you tour with you know certain bands. You try to get along.
Their overflated impression of themselves goes way back.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I can vouch for it. The Beatles, the Stones, and let me think. Zappa, we toured. We did a couple of shows with Zappa, and they were great. I mean, yeah, undoubtedly superb. And going back a little further, from back in the late '60s, two shows, and the shows that I'm going to mention are tours, are shows we were on. This is my first group signed with Dupree, the Big Sound. The first group, The Crazy World of Arthur Brown.
With the sterno on his head lit up and everything?
Oh, man. He and they were amazing. Oh. They were unbelievable. You know, Vincent Crane on the keyboard. They were unbelievable. And you know, Fire was like the last... But they were just ridiculously amazing. And then Hendrix.
Oh, wow.
We did a couple of shows in Germany with them, the Jimi Hendrix Experience. And, you know, my first group, we were pretty damn good too, by the way. we learned the hard way. You know, we toured and toured and toured. But when we played with Hendrix, there's no one that could blow Hendrix off the stage. They were absolutely superb, brilliant. Hendrix is just like what you think and what you saw and what you hear about him is less than what he was. So, you know, these people are, these icons are iconic for a reason, you know, and they remain iconic.
Sure, absolutely. It's not hype, folks.
No, it's not hype.
Definitely not. Well, Noah, did you want to hit it or you want to stick around a little longer?
Yeah, I think I'll let you guys, you know, shoot the shit. And
No. What about your bands? I know what band you're going to say. One of the bands I signed.
Oh, yeah. Well, some of my earliest shows.
Your concert memories.
Oh, I mean, it definitely has to be Bon Jovi for sure. Atco. Oh, yeah. Well, Pantera.
I got to let you guys in on a little secret. First concert I went to, I was 16. It was in Kansas City. And I grew up an hour away in little old Topeka, Kansas. And the thought of me going to the big city all alone with a bunch of my teenage friends did not appeal to my parents until I was 16. And even then, they weren't crazy about it. They knew they had to let go sometime. First show I saw was the Scorpions in 1984. And guess who opened?
Bon Jovi. Of course. Right. I know. I remember. Yeah. We put them on that show. The Scorpions, Kiss, Van Halen, Rat, to learn how to be a rock band.
Yeah, well, at the time I was kind of looking at my watch, but in hindsight, wow, I'm no psychic, man, or I wouldn't have hit that deer 10 years ago and I wouldn't have said Bon Jovi, who are they? Where are they going, you know? but a couple albums later, their songwriting really, you know, tightened.
And they became a great, entertaining, metal pop metal band, and Noah first saw them when he was about 2 years old, and my wife Sharon, we all went along, and his mom Carol Bon Jovi held Noah in the VIP section, and Noah was like jigging along, waving his hands, and she turned to me and said, "This kid's gonna do real well." That's a true story. And then he's got the shows but two kids were always at shows, and when I took him to the Pantera show, when I first signed them to ADCO, we got pictures of Phil and Dimebag, Noah. Rousting you like hell, right? No,
shoving a beer down my throat at like, I don't know, 10, 12, maybe earlier. those guys were still personally to this day. They're one of my favorite bands and some of the best live acts, I think, still to this day.
What's the most underrated Pantera album? Southern Trendkill?
I mean, Trendkill's a fucking phenomenal record. I wasn't a huge fan of Reinventing the Steel. That was obviously the last one. It was like, but yeah, I mean, I remember going out and buying Trendkill, and it was like 96, I think it was. Far Beyond Driven, that was the number one record, which is crazy that it did that.
I remember being, I was at Tower Records at midnight, the night that went on sale, but I was there to buy Talk from Yes. And everybody else was digging Pantera, and I'm like, rip open that other box there and give me one of those Talks, But yeah, I remember that night well.
Yeah.
But Pantera, were and still are, two remaining members, superb musicians. I mean, we're talking about players that could play their asses off.
Oh, yeah.
And man, were they great players.
Oh, they were. They just really... redefine metal for the 90s,
I'll tell you a quick story, which is a sidebar to whatever Freehand is about and everything else. I was running a company called ATCO Records. That's what I did. I joined the dark side, became Darth Vader. And generally as when you run a company, I was interested in when I was at Polygram.
There's a little ATCO for you.
Yeah, that's it. That was my company. Yeah, absolutely. Oh, that was Yes, though. Okay, yeah.
Pretty big record.
Yeah. Yeah, that was part of it. So I went down to, I had a scout go to see them first. Actually, I was interested in them when I was at Polygram. And I said to the attorney, hold off because I'm going to be changing my, I think I'm going to over go to Warner's and oversee this new company. And I went down to Arlington, Texas. And, when you've been in the business this long and you see a group and you think, damn, I hope they're good. I hope they're as good as I hope they are and the think they are. And I went down, and there was about 35 people in the audience. It was like a party or something. And I stood there, you know, arms, you know, to, in the back, and you know, just okay, start up. And they started. Third song in, I was like, okay. I almost got in the mosh pit myself, you know, almost, not quite. I did, but they were just. I became a gigantic fan. But I did know, and this is a sidebar to what we're talking about here. And it's a business thing, so please don't get bored about this. But I knew that this band would never be on MTV. This is the era of MTV. This band would never get on the radio. But boy, if they could convert me as this old, you know, sort of old fart executive and convert me into a major fan who just wanted to see the play again, I put my money that I had available to them to tour and go play to any audience you could. And sure enough, they went out there, and you know, if they couldn't afford to their overheads, I'd supplement their overheads. And sure enough, they got their audiences. And then, you know, one night in March, they play Philadelphia to 50 people. They come back in September and play to 5,000 people, because the word of mouth was just like insane.
Sure. And that, you know, that Cowboys from Hell album really took off, you know.
Yeah, it really
did. Funny, you know, I had a roommate back in the mid 80s that was into all this kind of rare metal that you usually had to buy in the back of like Hit Parader magazine or from these import places. But he had some American stuff too. And I remember he had the first Pantera album in his collection. So I was kind of aware of them before their, you know, big break, I guess. Oh, they were going through their hair metal, Def Leppard kind of phase. Right. I'm just curious, when you heard them, were they already starting to write stuff that was more in the vein of Cowboys, or was it still like the tail end of that hair metal kind of era?
I heard about them because I know Dallas fairly well. So I knew power metal, you know, but I've heard that they were, I mean, live-wise, when Phil joined the band, which is on the third album that was not released, their third album, the band changed radically. And I heard about it, and I thought, wow, this is something that I'd heard about down in the south, you know, west of Texas, and people are talking about it. And then an attorney friend of mine showed me a video, a VHS video of how they looked and what they were doing. And they were into the writing process of Cowboys. In fact, one of the songs was an early version of Cowboys from Hell. And I thought, okay, this is a band. I just have a feeling about that. I mean, I just have a feeling about that that could be as important as they became. And when I went over to Warner's and started running Atco Records, that was probably the first signing I made. So anyway, that was a side story from Gentle Giant Freehand, but it certainly all to do with music and being great musically and being pioneers and being authentic.
Sure.
Absolutely. And that's what they were too.
Well, they definitely were. And I think their change in sound was perfect because, you know, the whole hair metal thing was played out by the end of the 80s anyway. And it just seemed like it kind of set the stage for the 90s in a nice way that was more groove oriented. You know, it's almost like you could hear the ZZ Top in their grooves, you know, Texas boogie kind of thing. And that's more fun than this kind of straight up sterile, precise metal stuff that a lot of bands lean on. I always thought that was what really drew me in, was that kind of that groove that underpinned it all. So it was, different. Yeah. You know, it was like groove metal, I guess I'd call it.
You know? Yep.
Any other favorite shows, Noah?
Oh man, I'm trying to think. I mean, I when I was in around high school time, that's when all the big Ozfest, festivals were happening. I just remember though, because I got to see I am still a huge metal fan. But yeah, those Ozfests around 96 to 90, or it was like 97 to 99, were just like packed with everyone I loved at the time, at least. It was, you know, everyone from like Typo Negative to Machine Head to Fear Factory to Marilyn Manson. Slipknot. It was in 99, their first tour. I remember meeting them without their masks for the first time, and it was the weirdest thing ever. So that was my first you know, interaction with them is without masks. So,
right.
Can't think of any off the top of my head, but
were you enamored with the whole prog thing too? Kind of growing up here and hearing it, you know, in the background occasionally, or
I didn't understand or appreciate it till much later, but I'm definitely not like super, super like knee deep in the prog world. I think some of the bands that I listened to in the metal world sort of touched a little bit on that. People like Meshuggah and like Dillinger Escape Plan that had these just more so like the off timing, what they would call math rock, yeah, I guess.
Exactly.
But yeah.
I didn't really understand. Your calculators and let's rock.
yeah. So, but yeah.
Anybody you'd love?
Go ahead. Sorry.
Anybody you'd love to see that you haven't seen yet?
Well, I saw Aerosmith was on that list for years, and I saw them it's probably at least 5+ years now ago. So I'm really glad I saw them. I'm trying to think who else was on my list. You know, I think I mean, Dad, you can tell me. I don't know if I actually, I was probably too young, but AC/DC is definitely up there. Yeah. I don't know if I've actually seen AC/DC.
Yeah, you did.
I was probably two then, or two or three. So
AC/DC, man, they're live. You couldn't get better.
Oh yeah,
Angus, you come on. You know, let's get real. I mean,
I caught him a few times in the 80s. One time they had Yngwie opening. It was an interesting double bill. So,
Yngwie, I could do without. I'm sorry. Sorry, fans, but you know, like,
well, a lot of notes.
A lot of notes, but kind of a semi.
And I remember at the time, I thought, how does he remember all that? And the answer is he doesn't. He just thinks, no. E hit harmonic minor. Whoop! Let it rip.
AC/DC, yeah, absolutely. They're superb, and I work with them. So, you know, I got them, I did the Razor's Edge and got them back into being, you know, popular again. That was something which I'm proud of.
That was a good record. I remember that.
That was early a great 90s. Record. You know, yeah. Thunderstruck, are you kidding?
Yeah, come on. That's one of their biggest ones ever. I'm sure you've seen the one with the guys with the two cellos doing that version. That was such a
Oh, yeah. That was great.
Hit about 10 years ago.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. Well, yeah. Freehand.
I'll let you guys go. Yeah, I'm going to hit it. But yeah, so definitely look to all the socials for new stuff. I've also go ahead.
I just want to say I appreciate you guys sharing all the information about the shows before and after the fact. I really appreciate that very much. Thank you.
It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that. You know, because
for sure
we're rolling. It's been a good year, you know. All right, take care, Noah.
Yeah, have a good night.
Next time you do a shirt, let's get together and talk about it.
We'll do it.
All right, don't do it one without me.
I will. All right, see you guys.
All right, see
you. Bye.
See ya.
Always good to see him. He does such great work for you guys.
Yeah, and obviously he works at Sony. I don't know if you know that.
I think you mentioned.
So he's a creative director for a legacy band. So he has to get involved. Just FYI, in other legacy bands. So he's talking to me about David Gilmour and how difficult he is and how easy Eddie Vedder is to work with. And, you know, he has to work with all the other old farts out there too. So it's not just his dad, it's other.
That's very interesting.
He works with all these, even like Barbara Streisand and et cetera, et cetera.
Speaking of David Gilmour, do you remember the first time you saw the Floyd? Did you see him with Sid before he came along?
We toured with Pink Floyd back in the very early days, and they were awful.
Were they high the whole time, you think?
They were loud. I mean, we were talking about major loud, and they were pretty grim, actually. They couldn't play. This is back when they first started, when Sid Barrett was in the band, and they first had Arnold Lane.
Right.
And then it became good, but initially, when they played live, I mean, they just come from, you know, playing these psychedelic clubs. And I'm talking about the days of my Simon with Dupree and the Big Sound.
Sure, yeah.
And we did several shows with them. And again, they weren't that friendly, to be honest with you. But nevertheless, you know, they weren't unfriendly, but they were kind of like, I think they were a little high, actually. That's probably the reason.
Well,
acid and, you know, whatever they took and God knows what else. but they were, you know, they had a lot of, you know, color light wheels and lots of effects. But honestly, but with their advance, and they were the first group, by the way, that ever got an advance for an EMI. That was the very first group ever. And they got £5,000 or something, and they bought big, these gigantic Selmer amps, which were way too loud for these little clubs they played. And yeah, they were again, they weren't very good, but obviously they turned into a spectacular group.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, everybody's got to start someplace.
Of course. As General Giant and probably Simon Dupree did. You know.
I think I remember hearing Nick Mason say that, he hardly even played drums when he got signed. He's lucky if he had 100 hours under his belt.
So well, I'm not going to get into that before, but yeah, it appeared that way, but that's, I don't know the story behind that.
Well, I just think that's probably part of the reason that it was rough is they, didn't have a whole lot of miles under their belt yet, but right. It's all got to start someplace. So, right. So Freehand, I believe this is the sixth album. This is the one after In a Glass House. Am I right? Or am I getting my chronology?
Yeah, I think it's sixth or seventh. I'm not sure. I think it's around that period of time.
And what studio did you record it at?
At Anvision, which is our favorite go-to studios studio. It was a fantastic experience. Actually, I've done a couple of other interviews and talked about what it was like. And that period of time was a very good period for the band. I mean, we felt very strong. We felt like a strong bond between the band. We felt very confident in what we were doing. So it was a very good period, and we were a mature band. We felt very mature, both on a live basis, and also our writing was very much more written in a mature way. So I think Freehand was part of a period of time when the band was kind of like at its best in a lot of ways, both live and in recording.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's become one of your classics, and there's some great footage out there of you all playing live as well. I forget this thing, it's called Sight and Sound.
That's right.
The white jumpsuit show.
Don't embarrass me about that. I look back and say, boy, was I trying to be Freddie Mercury or something? Well, God almighty.
Work on somebody's car.
Exactly that. Somebody should have told me. Somebody should have said, Derek, that looks like shit. Take it off.
I think it's cool. Keith Moon had a similar getup around 75 or so, I remember. So
yeah, well, Keith was cooler than me.
So when you were writing this record, do you remember any particular things about this particular record as it was coming together?
It was written fairly quickly. I mean, we wrote it in a we never took our lot. We never, as you probably know, and we've probably discussed this before, we never jammed. We were very precise in the way we recorded and or wrote our music. Generally, it was, Kerry and Ray who would come up with a riff or some pieces of music on a Revox, and you do sound on sound and bring in other parts. So the parts would come in, and about two thirds or a half of the song was piece of music was written when we presented it to the band. Occasionally I'd come up with an idea, especially on Freehand, I'd come up with a couple of ideas and do the same thing. That pretty much it was written in about 6 weeks. We booked the recording studios, and I think it was recorded in a fairly swift period of time, within 4 weeks, and mixed in six. So I think we were really, on our game. And one thing that we did was work. We worked hard. I mean, we didn't shirk.
No, you guys weren't like that.
And, we were very clear-headed in what we wanted to do. But as I said, I think that the band was, we felt mature. We felt good about being where we were at that point. And I think, the live shows were going great. I mean, we were headlining in most places and fairly big places for the most part. And that's interesting, because it's interesting to me when I read about Gentle Giant that it's undersung. Well, And it probably is in certain respects, because obviously other bands of, if you like, in the progressive world are, I mentioned before, the name of Gentle Giant is mentioned. But we played to big, big audiences. I mean, in like Quebec, we played to 30,000 people. In Italy, we played 20,000 seaters, you know, and sell them out. But it was under the radar. The reason probably was and is because we never had a commercial hit. And that's something that we couldn't do. You know, it was something that the other bands of that period of time developed into a band that had a song that would be a big hit on the radio. And we never did, and we couldn't do it. So that's why it was a 10-year career. And it was time to stop after Civilian. But getting back to the Freehand, no, it was a great experience. I have very good memories of doing that album.
And what is the Freehand? What are you implying lyrically?
Well, lyrically, it was a period of time after we had gotten out of certain contractual situations, which were not a little detrimental to the band, and also with management changing and having a hands-on. A hands-on approach to taking the band to a different, to a bigger dimension and a bigger audience. So we felt like we had gotten out of some of the things that we got into earlier on, and so that was the freedom and the free hand. And in fact, that just I was going to mention to Noah. He probably doesn't even know this. That free hand, by the way, is Ray's. It's his left hand. Because he had the best hands of the band, because he was a violin player, so that was his left hand. You know, it's his, for his fretboard and for his so that was Ray's hand.
Wow. Oh, God. Well, I'd be curious to see the original picture. I'm probably not even around anymore, but
I don't know, but maybe you could speak to Ray and have him send you a picture of his free hand.
No doubt. I find this album to be, incredibly intricate, but very accessible. And that's a tough balance, but you guys usually pull it off. But I'd say out of a lot of your albums, this might be the one that I would give someone to start with if they had never heard Gentle Giant before. And I just think that the title track is, one of my top five Gentle Giant tunes. You know, it just kind of encapsulates all of the things I love about the band. Do you have any memories of recording the title track or putting it together?
Freehand or just the same?
Freehand.
That was Kerry's song.
I love that clavinet. That's just, that makes it,
Yeah, you know what's interesting to me is that a couple of people have mentioned it to me, and they brought up something which is, I think, quite important for fans and us, that we were a funky band. John was an incredible drummer. I mean, just ridiculous. And it's a funky song. I mean, we're talking about funk rock, actually, in a certain way. It was Kerry's song, and he pretty much brought it in its entirety to the band. I knew that that's kind of where we were going to go. So we brought it to me, and we sat down together. And Ray came in and put in some parts on it. And then we rehearsed it together and recorded it fairly quickly. I know that. What we do generally, recording-wise, is play it all together, because we rehearsed before, play it all together and used, scratch vocals, scratch guitars, and kept the drums and bass, because we liked the key thing was having a live feel. And we usually grabbed it in the first or second take, without any kind of like overdubs or punch-ins or whatever.
Is there any click track?
No.
No.
No. The only album, I think, Acquiring the Taste was click tracks. No, no, and in fact, that's probably why it's funky. You can't play funk to click tracks.
No, because the click track just evens it out and kills a lot of the dynamics.
Yeah, it's not music when it's click. I mean, you've got to be human.
We've seen in this modern age that perfect music doesn't necessarily sound good. You know, it seemed like in the 70s, there was this relentless push for perfection. You know, guys like Steely Dan, practically, you know, the first guys to quantize a drum beat. And did it make it better? No, I don't think.
Oh, this is, you know, I love them. You know what? There's some mistakes in a lot of the albums we've made, and whether they're, anyone sees them or hears them or whatever, they're human. And you know, in fact, it's way up. No, that's in a glass house. You know, when Gary shouted "Go," that wasn't that in the Way of Life. We left it in. You know, things are left in because it's human. We were, I mean, computerized music. I mean, we were musicians, and we love to play music. And for me, God knows how many years later. I mean, I do know how many years later. 42 years later. 41 years later. For us to talk about music that was done, or even longer, 44, 5 years later, seems relevant today. I think it says a lot.
Yeah. Have you ever thought about what the band's music would have been like had you not broken up and gone on into the 80s? Do you think you would have embraced all the modern DX7s and all those?
I think the hypothesis is hilarious, but to think about that, I think we would have embraced everything. But I think that we could not have done it because the truth is, in the 80s, if you didn't have a hit single, you kind of drifted into oblivion.
Right.
And I think we, at some point towards the end of the band, we tried to be a little more commercial, and we always kind of found a way to fuck it up. Excuse my French, because in certain respects, it was almost, I won't say a death wish, but almost a way to say, we can't do this. We're not Genesis. We're going to screw it up because if we become a commercial band, that's not Gentle Giant.
Right.
You know, and a couple of attempts didn't work. And look, it wasn't for trying, but it would have been wrong. And I think had we gone into the 80s and 90s, we'd have tried all sorts of things. But I think it would have been redundant because you started to become a parody of what you once were. And that's some of the things I've seen other bands do and try to recreate who they were when they were in their 20s and even teens and play the same music that was they did at their zenith and not as well. It's a little depressing for me.
Sure.
And I think that goes for the rest of the whole band.
Well, honestly, I'm kind of glad that you guys just called it a day then, because I don't know. It's like, I have mixed feelings about seeing some of your peers go into the 80s. I mean, a lot of them got a second chance, luckily, but it was almost like they put on a mask for the decade and became something else in a lot of ways. Well,
yeah, which I don't judge. It's fine, exactly that. You know, and what they became and who they are is good for them. But it wouldn't have been good for Gentle Giant. It wouldn't have been good for anyone.
So a couple more questions about Freehand. On Reflection, can you tell us a bit about that one? You know, this is like the Baroque vocal chorale, and it's not the first time you guys had hinted at that kind of stuff by any means, but I think that's probably the song that has it realized the most. I was just curious if you could share.
That was Carrie's classical training. That was scored. That was completely scored.
A part in mind for everybody and kind of gave it to each of you, and it went from there. Okay.
Yeah, that was a four-part, you know, scored vocal chorus, if you like. It was the fugue. It was actually kind of fugue-ish, actually. Yeah.
Well, that's a classic. You know, that's just like, if anybody needs to point at one vocal, you know, peak for Gentle Giant, I would play them that first, I think.
Well, that's Carrie's, I mean, amazing compositional skills. I mean, he really was an incredible composer, bar none, and should have gone on to be, and probably, I think, hopefully, in certain respects, in Gentle Giant's legacy, if you like, should be revered as a very important composer, because he really has the chops.
Absolutely. Yeah. Beautiful. Beautiful.
As we all did in certain respects, but certainly carry in, right.
Now, I know you guys didn't just sit in a room and jam things up, but when you wrote the pieces, was it a collective thing, or was it more like Carrie would write freehand and then you guys would come in and decorate that? Or were there songs where people wrote, you know, maybe Gary wrote the bridge and Carrie wrote the chorus? I mean, were there ones that worked like that as well?
Occasionally, but not too often. I'm trying to think. You mentioned On Reflection, that was Carrie. I could point out, and a couple of the songs on Freehand, I brought in a couple of ideas, actually got Ray to help me out. I got my Revox together and put a couple of riffs down and put it down, and I can't remember which one it was. It was a couple of songs. I said, Ray, come over and we'll work on this. So, I do on a musical basis. And then we'd work it up till we had, a fairly complete song. And the same thing was with Carrie. Carrie composed on a keyboard, of course, and Ray would compose on a guitar, and I would do the same thing with guitar. And you do sound on sound on a Revox, and you pretty much bring it in fairly well put together. And then, obviously, when we rehearsed it, we'd leave open spaces for Gary to improvise his licks and John. I mean, John was an incredible drummer and got every part perfectly right on the money. I mean, he was just a driving force. So, I was very lucky to have such a great musician, a musical team behind me. I mean, we're all lucky, but I certainly felt that way.
Absolutely. Couldn't have asked for better, And, how about Time to Kill? Any memories of that one? You know, that's the one that had the futuristic video game sound at the beginning. That sounds so...
Actually, that's one I wrote. I mean, that's I wrote
dun,
that.
Dun, dun, da, 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 that one, that's your riff there.
Yeah.
Very cool.
So, the Pong sound, and the Pong, the intro. And I brought that along to Ray, and Ray embellished it together with me. And then we'd bring it to the band. But it's, I could pretty much just hear, and you could pretty much hear Ray's and Carrie's compositional differences. And Carrie's much more sort of, very much classical inclined, and used to score things occasionally. I mean, not occasionally, quite a lot of times. And we'd have to learn the parts. And again, it was a jam band. We'd never jammed. And said, let's get together in a studio, or let's get together in a rehearsal hall, and John put a drum down, and let's get our guitars together. That, only if we're having fun and we play, some soul music or some Stones or God knows what else, but never, hey, just let's just play. That didn't make sense to us.
Wonderful materializes if we mess around.
No, doesn't work.
Time's
not for us.
Don't waste it like that.
Yeah. Again, we were pretty diligent about working hard to get whatever it was recorded. And then we'd work hard after the recording to present it live, which is always different, as you know. And the live versions were quite different to the recorded versions, and sometimes better, because we were able to, present it in a different fashion. So it was a lot of fun. I mean, it was a lot of fun to present that song, but not the same song that you heard on the record. We'd embellish it with different things and solos and all the other bells and whistles you see on stage.
I think my favorite version of Freehand is that one on the Sight and Sound video, because there's that wonderful wah-wah solo that Gary throws in there that isn't on the original. And it's like, just love it.
Great solo. Yeah. Oh, Gary, incredible blues player. I mean, incredible soloist. I mean, man, you said, Gary, take it away. Okay. He's taking it away.
Yeah. Love it. Who were some of the groups that were opening for you guys once you were headlining?
Let me think. Renaissance.
Well, that's a good double.
PFM.
Wow.
Star Castle. I can't remember. There's so many. I can't string everything. I mean, so many other bands I've forgotten about. But there was a couple of the tour on tour of the US, we took on what was it, the punk band? I'm blanking. The Stranglers. Well, and I felt so bad for them.
That's a little.
It different. Was almost. It was almost like Gentle Giant and Black Sabbath.
Right. It's like your fans wanted to strangle the Stranglers.
Oh man, our fans were killing the Stranglers. Those poor guys were so upset. Like
we're throwing recorders at them.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. Recorders and oh, poor guys. You know. So we went into their dressing. You're doing great. You're doing great. Don't worry about it. But they were getting. They were having a hard time with our audience.
Yeah,
there are plenty of bands, and you know, we double build with a lot of bands too, of course.
Yeah. I love those stories because there's just so many classics back there. I'd like to talk a little bit about some of that when we talk about the early days a little bit here in a minute. But I wanted to touch on the remixing Stephen Wilson did. And just get your thoughts on it. And, you know, he's the go-to guy for these, you know, for a reason. You know, he's got great ears, great taste.
Yeah.
He doesn't go out of his way to change things radically. You know, I think he's very respectful of the original intent, but like, it's almost like wiping a window clean, if you would.
So, yeah, that's exactly what he does. And that's why we enjoy what he does. And when, I mean, he's actually remixed a couple of other albums going forward.
I heard, that interview might be coming down the pike before too terribly long.
Interview and Missing Piece and maybe some other, another. But Stephen's great. I mean, he's a fan. Ray worked with him. Actually, that's how we met, because Ray worked with him on his album, because Ray does 5.1 mixes for a lot of bands,
right.
And we became friends. And Stephen said, "Man, I would love to work with you guys on whatever, but I'd love more than anything to work on in a glass house, because I think that could use a different sound and a different mix." And we said, "Yeah, that'd be great," but unfortunately, no one could find the multis.
No.
So that's a tragedy in itself, because it's an iconic record that has a lot of emotion for all of us, actually, because that was the album that we recorded after my brother Phil left,
right.
And so we were a five piece, and it was the memories of those days were kind of like very mixed. It was like, okay, and that was it was an album which is very jarring, but also very creative in its own way. It's almost like you need that kind of like big shakeup to make something which is quite different. And in retrospect, I mean, I didn't like that album for a long time. It just evoked terrible memories for me about my brother, you know, leaving the band and having, you know, and that's you know, for memory's sake, it was not pleasant. But after, you know, a period of time, I revisit it and think, boy, it was a great turning over of a leaf and becoming much more focused as a five piece and more of a rock band than a sort of a band that was kind of finding itself, if you like. We found ourselves as a five piece.
And you know, I find this a lot doing these interviews, that you know, the circumstances behind the recording of a record really has a way of coloring the memory of it later. Like,
oh, yeah.
Certain albums, like Yes's Union album, they all hate it because it was, you know, a clusterfuck, and there's a bunch of studio musicians on it because some of the Yes guys weren't Yes-y enough to make the producer happy. But you know what? It's not a bad batch of songs, you know. I mean, it's no close to the edge. But I didn't know about this baggage, you know. And I think that's true with Glass House as well, because it's actually one of the fan favorites, you know. I've done a few polls over the years, and it always ranks very high. You know, the people that love it really love it.
Yeah, in fact, I mean, I didn't like it but I didn't like it because it evoked a lot of memories which were hurtful. Not for the music, but the music is, and I realized actually afterwards, after quite a long period of time, that the hurtful memories and all the other parts, that parts of our emotions, both myself and Ray, and the rest of the band, of course, it made for a very interesting record, and probably a very good record, actually.
Yes. I think I prefer Power of the Glory more, but Glass House is a great one. Yeah, absolutely. And I think it falls between the cracks sometimes. I don't know if it's because it just, remember that was the one that wasn't released in the U.S. forever, I think. And
yeah, that's correct.
That lingers even now in a weird way. You know?
Yeah. Well, we haven't been able to sort of do much with it because there's no multis out there. There's no, I mean, so I wish there were. Because we could certainly make a bit of a noise with that.
Now, did Stephen Wilson remix everything up to Freehand, all those albums, or did he just do certain ones? And if so, which?
No, he did Power and the Glory. He did Octopus. He did the best of the first, what was it called? Three-piece suite, because right. That was a three, and did he do Three Friends? No, I don't think so.
I don't think so.
No.
Okay.
But he's obviously done Power and the Glory and now Freehand, and he's mixed The Missing Piece, which is actually really good, and Interview. We'll see whether we want to, you know, we have just a reference point here. We have Civilian back into our repertoire. This is the last record that a lot of fans were disdainful of when we did it. I like this album a lot. I mean, I have to tell you.
It's a good rock record. You know, I find it more satisfying than Giant for a Day, although that one has a few songs I like.
Yeah, Giant for a Day, it was certainly an attempt, I have to admit, to be a little more commercial. And when I said that we would be, in certain respects, self-destructive, I think that's probably the reason. We weren't commercial. We couldn't do it. And I think we wrote the song which said, I bet you thought we couldn't do it. Well, we couldn't do it. So therefore, you know, let Genesis and Yes and ELP did it. We didn't. So enough said.
I think Genesis made, you know, bridged the gap into the 80s better than anybody.
You know? I agree.
Yes did it by trying to start a new band.
they were lucky enough to get Trevor and the song and Trevor Horn and get this pop song, which was not really them playing. It was Trevor basically doing his magic with, you know, Frankie Goes to Hollywood. But nevertheless, it was a great track, a great Yes track, and it reestablished Yes as a name, and good for them.
Yeah, well, I'm glad it happened, you know.
Yeah, and me too.
You know,
absolutely.
And in hindsight, the 80s, Yes, is quality stuff. You know, I mean, they always had great players. They always set the bar high.
Yeah.
You know, and they couldn't have made a record like Close to the Edge in 1983 anyway. You know, it was very fresh in 1973, just like 90125 was fresh in 1983, you know. So
correct. Yeah.
Roll with the changes, as they say.
Well, that's the thing about music and musicians. And if you like progressive music, because you have to progress. And you asked me a question a little earlier about would Gentle Giant had gone on to different things and different styles and accepted and sort of, you know, who use computers and various, probably, yeah. And in fact, I think in a strange way, probably the most progressive music I hear today is in the hip hop world. Mm. If you listen to some of these hip hop, really good hip hop stuff, you'll hear progressive music because they use different things. You'll never know what they're going to use as their samples and their beats. Even they're not something which is machine driven. Some of these very, very clever hip hop producers and artists are progressive as hell. I mean, as easily progressive as Gentle Giant.
And in fact,
just as a reference point, again, a lot of these hip hop artists are big Gentle Giant fans. I don't know whether you know that, but you know, we've had several.
I feel like we talked about something being sampled.
Yeah, we did. Recently. Yeah, we did say that before. Yeah,
and there's great music in every genre. You know, I sometimes feel like the stuff that we hear in the top 40 is not really the cream of the crop. It's just kind of, you know, it's easily digestible for the masses, and that's why it's so popular. You know,
well, I
mean, there's a reason McDonald's sold 50 billion hamburgers. You know, because
of course, yeah. And again, but you know, I have an issue sometimes with, and it's only me, and I'm, you know, it sounds like an old fart griping, but you know, the TikTok world, and you have to have something in 5 seconds. If you don't have the hook or the chorus or whatever you're going to sell in 5 seconds, it's dead. And boy, music is not in 5 seconds worth of, you know, like just 5 seconds worth of chorus. It's a little more than that. But again, I'm not a TikTok fan. I'm not a, you know, I don't scour the internet for the latest trends or fashion. So, but that's certainly part of it. And it's, you know, it's very scientific. It's very, very, put together in a purely marketing level, which is okay, but you know, marketing is important.
It amazes me how some of these artists, you look at the credits and like 10 guys help write a song. How do 10 guys write one song?
I mean, well, it's we know what it's about. It's about, you know, programming and getting the right all of the right stuff that you put into one thing, which is which is today, but I wish that it wasn't in some ways, because it's authentic in its own way, but I don't think, you know, again, I'm just being, I don't know me curmudgeonly, but I don't think that when history looks back at a period of time in 100 years, of a period of time in 50 years, that a lot of the sort of computerized music that has been done on, you know, these machines that have algorithms that give you the choruses and give you and in fact, choruses have come out and gone out the window, by the way, now. There's no chorus anymore.
Well, forget bridge. I haven't heard a good bridge in 15
years. Oh, a bridge? Are you kidding? There's no bridges. There's
like, what chorus. The heck's that?
No, there's no chord changes. It's basically one song, one chord.
I know.
And
it's like, it doesn't have to be this way, does it?
I mean, apparently it is. So, you know what?
It seems like the shortest route to the end result possible.
But that's the world of the streaming world and the music not being as important to the general public as it used to be when I was growing up, certainly probably you.
Yeah, absolutely. I got a couple more questions. Last time we talked last summer, you were in the middle of some reissues on vinyl of the first four albums. Are there plans to do the albums after that also? Yes. Okay.
Yep. The next four.
You inspired me to go pick them up, and I want to collect them all eventually. So I'm glad to hear there's more coming.
Yep. Yeah, the next four. Yep. And then we'll put the vinyl is I love vinyl. I do. I really I've got my, you see it over there, my turntable over there, and I even have a sound system, which yeah, it's not a, I've got speakers and a tuner and everything else like the old days.
What was the last record you just played for fun?
Wow, that's a good. I mean, you know what? I just played Aqualung.
Oh,
on vinyl.
Very cool.
What a great record.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It was probably the first prog record I ever remember hearing. Actually,
and Hot Rats.
Oh, there you go. Yes,
because I was cleaning out my closet. I've got hundreds of thousands actually of albums in there. And I was, let me just play this. And when I was on my turntable, and Hot Rats, man, what an album! You know, Pictures on Regalia. Gee, wow! How can you get better than that?
Well, it's such a magical piece of writing, you know, and it's a fun piece of music to play. I've actually had the pleasure a few times. And
oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, it's great.
I mostly play the chords and let other people play the fiddly bits, but I know it.
That's great. No, it's fantastic.
So I have a few questions in the chat room. Derek, why did you stop playing saxophone on the records on the last three albums?
That's a good question. Because I wasn't very good. Actually, no, I in fact, I've got my sax. What I did during the lockdown, as a reference point, is, you know, I have a sax, I've got my alto here, and I did a lot of playing and got pretty damn good at it. I mean, I was okay. I wasn't a great player, but, you know, I was a better guitarist, but I never played guitar because Gary was too good and so was Ray. I think that we were trying to focus a little more on being a sort of more rock band, if you like, rock band lineup.
Right.
So therefore the sax was less important than having the sort of sound of a real general rock band.
Okay. All right. My friend Brad, who co-hosted with us last time. Hey, Brad.
I remember him.
He says, in a Neil Morse Band making of the tour DVD, I saw Derek visiting with the band backstage at two different shows. How did you meet Neil initially?
Well, Neil's a pretty good friend. I met Neil through Mike Portnoy.
Okay.
And Mike Portnoy I met because I signed Dream Theater.
Sure. So you knew him quite well.
So, I mean, so Neil, in fact, emailed me tonight, actually. He's doing a podcast, et cetera, you know, et cetera. He'd like me to be on there. So I got to meet with him I didn't realize that he was a big fan and what a great guy and a great musician too, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
Prolific in Nashville and we met down there and it was a lot of fun. I met him, several times and he's a friend and, also a very nice man and a nice person and also a very good musician. Yeah. So I met him through Mike Portnoy, effectively.
Okay. That totally makes sense. Yeah. All right. My friend Alexander's wondering, were there bad relationship lyrics from Freehand and On Reflection based on an actual relationship that had gone sour?
Yes.
Was it the relationship with the record company or was it a girl?
Well, I've been married for 40 plus years, but there was a girl before that I almost got married to, but I didn't. That will keep under our hats for a while before the book is a tell all.
Okay. Yeah.
let's all go there right now. I don't want a divorce.
Yeah, no problem. A friend of mine says I did lights for Pantera at the Hollywood Palace in the late 80s. They scared the shit out of me.
They were pussycats, actually. They were really pussycats, but except for Phil when he was on a bad day. But, you know, but generally, what a great bunch of guys. I mean, as long as you were able to keep up with them drinking.
Yeah, exactly.
That was hardcore.
They're like Jack Daniels, for starters.
Jack, and you know, yeah, if you didn't do it with them, then they'd do it.
Grin, the mixture of Jägermeister and whiskey.
You got it right.
Yeah, I think I'd be feeling pretty good. I'd be feeling pretty good after a couple of those, I'm sure. My friend CJ wonders, why were the side two tracks of most Gentle Giant albums never performed live?
Which side two tracks are they?
I don't know. I guess he just thinks in general that most of the ones that are on the second side of the album didn't get as much attention and love as the
first. Actually, that's interesting because probably we'd load up the first track, the first side of the better songs. Although, you know, I'm thinking of Missing Pieces. The second side is a little better, and I think we did quite a few of those tracks. Again, our repertoire on stage was never the same as what we produced on a recording basis. So we stretch out these songs and do them in a very different fashion. For instance, what was the song? So Sincere, off of was it Acquiring the Taste? No, what am I talking about? That was off of Power and the Glory. But yeah. If you saw, you know, we do the drum bash. I don't know if you're familiar with that. What I always didn't like and we would never do is go off the stage and let Gary do a solo for like 20 minutes or John do a drum solo for like, you know, 15 minutes, you know, like a lot of bands do because they take their break and people cheer after it. But really it's like boring as hell. You know, after like 3 or 4 minutes, you know, that's it. It's basically the band taking a break. So in So Sincere, we all did the drums. If you remember, we all went on we had John surrounded with all the drums and then everyone would hit the xylophones afterwards. And that was our drum bash. That was a drum solo. And Gary would keep his solos, comparatively short, but when he did them, of course, they were superb. We didn't stretch out that stuff. It was boring.
Yeah. Okay. Let's see what else I have here. My friend Frank says, loved hearing both percussion bash and recorder ensembles in your live shows. Were they improv or were they all planned out in advance?
No. Everything, these kind of things you can't improv. I mean, they're actually scored and you have to put them together and then know when to do it. I mean, if you see the instrument changes, I mean, we had to be very precise. You know, there would be occasions where I'd, you know, be at the vocal mic, and then I'd be trying to grab the bass off Ray when he tried to get the violin, and you know, trip over the lead, and you know, and oh shit, let me plug it in, and God knows, let me get it in before I have to jump in with the bass there, with the bass line. So no, it was very, very coordinated and very organized and put together in rehearsals.
How did you like playing bass? I think I've seen more video of you playing the bass than any other instrument.
I really enjoyed it. It was fun. You know, it was fun because I would rock out to it with my bass lines.
You know? I play it occasionally myself, and it's just suddenly you're in the driver's seat in a lot of ways, you know? And
yeah. I started, you know, back in the day, when we first started as a group with Ray and my first group, I was the lead guitarist, you know, but I realized I couldn't sing and play lead guitar at the same time. I was not that great a lead guitarist. So thankfully I just put the guitar down and said, okay, let someone else take over. But you know, when in Gentle Giant, of course, you know, I could grab the bass from Ray when he was playing something else, the violin or the trumpet, or God knows what else he played, right. The guitar, everything.
Yeah, pretty much. Excellent. So I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about the early days. And you guys, did you grow up in the London area?
No, we grew up in a city called Portsmouth, which is on the south coast. It's about 60 miles from London. It's a naval port, but it wasn't in London, so there was no real scene. And my father was a jazz musician, so music was always in. I mean, he was a leader of a jazz dance band and a trumpeter, and then also he was a superb musician. I mean, he could pick up an instrument, any instrument. I think in certain respects, the genetic DNA went to his kids, and his, and here we are, and play them as well as anyone. So we grew up in Portsmouth, England, and that's in certain respects. And so when we recruited, when my first group was out of Portsmouth, and we were called Simon Dupree and the Big Sound. I'm sure everyone knows that. And we toured a lot. Actually, we became very popular as a touring band. In fact, those are the days when you played 9 or 10 gigs a week.
Sure.
I mean, literally, you would do overnighters and all-nighters, and if you weren't good, then if you didn't get good by that time, then you know you said, let's give it up and be a plumber or God knows what. So you learn your craft.
Now, was this right at the height of the psychedelic pop era, or was
it? Yeah, as far as the R&B, most of these bands, including Pink Floyd, including Genesis, including, you know, all the other bands were influenced by soul and R&B. I mean, all these bands started listening to American radio in England. You know, this is the beginnings of British rock. And in fact, I'll let you in into a little secret. I've been working on with a couple of partners of the beginnings of the best British rock in the mid to late 60s to 1971. Where all of these bands would tour up and down England, you know, whether it was the Graham Bond organization. I don't know if you know that they are.
Yeah, Jack Bruce. And Ginger
Jack
Baker.
Bruce. Yeah, Ginger Graham, Baker.
Graham's eccentric self.
Yeah, and all these other bands who were in different bands became, you know, Led Zeppelin were the Band of Joy and et cetera, et cetera. And the Idle Race was Jeff Lynne, and all these other bands would... Yeah, so all these bands would get together in this place called the Blue Boar Cafe on the M1. It was a cafe. It was the only thing open. in all of England, and everyone would congregate this shitty little cafe that sold beans on toast with an egg on top at 3 a.m. And you'd all meet up and say, what was your gig like in Nottingham? What was your gig like in Manchester? So you'd all get together as a sort of like, everyone would know each other. And that was a birth, effectively, of what the biggest music boom that came out of the UK, which eventually translated to the biggest boom in rock music, ultimately. So I'm working on a documentary with a couple of friends about that and those days, and as well as other things, which are different.
Well, it sounds like there might need to be a documentary that goes with that. That sounds like
that's what we're doing.
Good, okay. Excellent. Yep. Did you listen to pirate radio as a teen?
Yeah, but pirate radio, yes, of course, pirate radio.
Radio Luxembourg, that kind of stuff.
Radio Luxembourg was the essence. That's what you had to listen to. And in fact, you'd listen to it and get your own a tape recorder and listen to what the Radio Luxembourg was playing, as well as AFM, American Forces Network. And American Forces Network was primarily playing black soul music and R&B music. Music that isn't heard in America, but heard in overseas to the Americans posted overseas, which are primarily African Americans.
Sure.
So we listened to that, and all these bands, it became massive, would listen to those and say, let's play this. And the Stones and the Beatles and everyone else were completely influenced by those two stations, AFM and Radio Luxembourg.
Was it just a late night kind of thing, or did it go 24/7?
It was pretty much late night. I mean, we'd have to, after school, you know, we listened to them and as 12-year-olds, we turn on the tape recorder and, wow, listen to that. Wow, listen to that. Sure. This is English, you know, and whereas in America, they didn't even know what these things were.
Yeah.
So it was interesting that's actually an interesting point that a lot of Americans, a lot of people don't know that the British, well, I think they know now, were influenced by Americans' black music.
Oh, absolutely. You know, all those, you know, the Cream and, you know, all these groups, you know, and for me, for, you know, a lot of us Americans, we kind of got introduced to our own music via the British artists, you know, spitting it back at us, you know, through their filter. And I always like that British filter on the blues.
There was a British filter. That's the point. Yeah. There was a British filter to it. And you couldn't, you had to have that filter to make it something that it wasn't. Where it came from, Radio Luxembourg or American Forces Network. So it was a British take on American music.
Yeah, am I right that you couldn't really hear this kind of music on the BBC or any of the state-sanctioned radio stations?
They were playing, Perry Como or you know, the latest pop song or you know, the Honey Bunch or Force 4. I can't remember the bands, in fact.
Yeah.
Okay. In fact, Simon Dupree had a big hit at that point as well.
Kites, yeah.
Yeah.
The top. Which was one that you didn't really feel summed up the band that well.
Well, only because in retrospect, it probably did, actually, thinking about it, because it was something that was a precursor to what the band became. But at that point, we were a band that toured a lot. And we toured, we were kind of a soul R&B rock band that had a pretty damn big following all over Europe, actually. And that song was a very big hit, but a kind of different song to the kind of music we play live. And ultimately, it became a millstone around our necks, because we play venues that were, they used to call them scampi and chip circuit, where you'd play in front of people that were eating their, you know, their, again, Las Vegas-y kind of thing, eating their scampi and chips in their tables and wanting to hear the hits, you know, and that was so damn depressing. And that was depressing to the band, even though monetary-wise and financially it was very rewarding. But boy, playing to an audience like that who are waiting to hear the hits, that was the problem. And that was the signal to say, this is it, we're going to close, we're going to shut this damn band down, and let's play something we want to play, and not for these scampi and chips people. We want to play something that we like to do. And that was the beginning of Gentle Giant.
Have you ever sung Kites since Simon Dupree, even for fun, party or something?
Only to my kids. Okay. And Thanksgiving, and no one. I know Noah mentioned last time
that he used to, you know, talk you guys into singing some Gentle Giant, you know, at family functions.
I got my piano in the
studio. Any particular song that you guys did?
Hey, not Gentle Giant, so Hey Jude.
Oh, okay, more Beatles.
Yeah, Beatles. You know, just the old classics.
Yeah.
You know, and I'd get the guitars out and the bass out and get my little Selma amp out there I got a ton of guitars. So, but you know, very occasionally we'd do that. But maybe now things are more open. Yeah.
Do you ever get the urge to make new music?
I make new music quite a lot.
But what would a Derek Shulman album be like if it happened now?
I've got my little computer there, and it's over there, and I've got a little Pro Tool set up, and it's I like some of the stuff I've written is pretty good.
Yeah, well, it'd be nice.
but it's for me.
Yeah, well, it'd be good. I love your voice. I just love a chance to hear it again in a new context sometime. So.
Well, I mean, I think it was funny because having done you spoke to Noah earlier about the Proclamation video, and I thought, boy, could I hit those notes still? And I guess I could.
Yeah, well, I need more than a hail, Derek. I need a whole song.
Oh man, okay, you're asking for a lot, man. Yeah, Jesus Christ, here.
Prog.
Well, it wasn't a hail. It was a whole verse.
Okay. Oh yeah, that's right.
But it was edited as well. So I mean, he probably cut things out deliberately because out of tune. No, it wasn't out of tune actually. Wow. I made sure it was in tune.
That was such a great video. I love it. So interview may be coming next, you think?
Interview, yes, that will come at some point in the very near future. I think civilians.
How do you feel interview compares to freehand? Because I seem to see them kind of grouped together a lot of times. You can even sometimes buy a CD twofer with them both on there.
Interview, I like. Not as much as freehand. Freehand, I think interview has a bit of, how can I put this? A little bit of cynicism to it, which is not good for a band. And you know, talking about, you're bored about being interviewed again and this, that, and the other. It's a well put together album. And musically, it's very strong, but there's something about it that doesn't, it's not in my list of top three, if you like, because of, I know that where the band was headed, and, you know, when Freehand came out and boy, we were on a high but we weren't, I mean, we were touring and everything else, we were doing lots of interviews, but to people that didn't know the band, and that's the point. And we were getting very frustrated about, so tell me, it was the same interview every time, you know, not unlike this interview, of course.
I can imagine how frustrating that would be, talking to somebody that doesn't have a clue, you know, I mean.
Yeah, well, so, we, you know, that was Freehand was probably the most popular album commercially. And so we would go to various radio stations and they didn't have a clue who Gentle Giant was, but knew they had to interview us. And so they'd ask these mundane questions and we'd just like, you know, go from Fort Wayne to Peoria, you know, and God knows where else, with the same DJ who didn't have a clue who we were, right, or playing in town. And it was getting old, these interviews.
You know, I mean, one thing about my show is I only interview people whose music I really know and love. You know, I've gotten a lot of offers to interview people I don't know, and I usually pass because it's just like, I really need to feel invested in your music in some way, you know.
Well, you are, obviously. I hear it and see it, and I appreciate it, of course.
Well, thank you. Well, it's a pleasure just to, you know, hear the stories behind these records that I've loved for so many years from the people that made them. You know, it's
sure
been a great way to spend the past year. It's really, really saved my ass, honestly. I didn't have a whole lot else going on, but 96 episodes later.
Yeah, good for you. Congratulations. You've done great, good.
I appreciate it. And it's always a pleasure to chat with you. Is there anything else you'd like to mention before we wrap it up tonight?
No, just that I think I do believe that Stephen has done a really good job. I mean, I think what Noah was talking about, you know, the elements of music that he listened to, but I think what Stephen has done on this record. We left him alone, as we did with all the other mixes. And there's more clarity in the different instrumentation. And there's a lot more air and space in this mix than on the original mix. And the original mix was pretty good, but this is, I think this is one of the best mixes that Stephen's done for the band. Probably the best, actually. Because the album itself, I like personally too. I think it was probably my favorite too. But it's even more of a favorite because he's brought out pieces in the 5.1 surround sound. They're really, really clear and they're really precise, and it also gives us some air, some of the parts, and you can hear why the bass line did this and the guitar line did this and the sax line did this, and they do integrate really well, and you can hear them with nice clarity.
Excellent. Well, that's coming out again. What date? June what? 26th?
June 25th.
When, June 25th. And would we get that directly from your website, the Jungle Giant website, or will this be at all the typical outlets?
Amazon and all the other outlets. It's out there to buy and wherever you buy. God knows where you buy things anymore. But if there's record stores, which, you know, is a shame, but I think they're coming back, actually, which is nice to hear. And it's, you know, it'll be streamed, but certainly there'll be physical product, and you know the Atmos mix is great.
A whole new ball game. Is how would you describe that compared to 5.1? The Atmos, Dolby Atmos.
Yeah, Dolby Atmos. I don't have that Dolby Atmos here, so Ray has a special
stereo just to play it.
Exactly that. So I don't have that, but it's apparently really ultra high end, and it sounds spectacular. So Ray says. I mean, I'll take his word for it.
Yeah, so it's like it's a surround kind of thing, but it's better than any surround we've heard up to this point.
Yeah, it's. I can't even give the specifics of the sort of whatever the analytics are, but it's probably the highest end, you know, audio you could get.
Okay, well, I'm sure we'll be hearing a lot more about that in the next few years. You know, so that's going to be great. All right, well. Next week, I am chatting with the California Guitar Trio. Well, two out of three, I'm chatting with Bert and Paul. You know, they're going to open for King Crimson coming up in July on the first leg of their tour, followed by the Zappa Band, fronted by Mike Keneally with the Zappa alumni. Cool. So you're going to see a great double bill no matter where you are, pretty much. I'm going to catch them here in Atlanta at the Fox Theater, which is like the most beautiful old theater in town, and what a wonderful setting. It's like, you know, seeing King Crimson and Camelot is what it reminds me of.
We played there at the Fox, I remember.
Back in the 70s, it's such a grand place, and they, you know, it almost got torn down back in the 70s. They had a big Save the Fox campaign, and
I remember.
Thank God they saved it, because, you know, we need places like this. You know, you just,
so the Crimson are going with a big lineup again, with the three drums and all the bells and whistles, right?
Yeah, the three drummer lineup up front, where they pass the fills around like hot potatoes.
And Jacko's singing as well. Fun to watch.
I've never really seen anything like this, and some people are like, oh, it takes three drummers to take Bill Bruford's place. And it's like, no, you don't get it. That's not what's going on. Even Bill Bruford would be impressed with this, because they're doing things that rock drummers have never done. So, well, you know.
Nice. It'll be a lot of fun to watch. I mean, you know, and see it here.
Oh, yeah. Always a pleasure to see them. So anyhow, California Guitar Trio will be next week. The following week, we're going to look under the hood at Genesis Music. And I have a show every couple months with a music educator friend of mine, where we peel apart the layers and show how certain bands are put together. We did a great show about Steely Dan a couple months ago that was really popular. So with the tour coming, I thought we'd look at Genesis, and especially Tony Banks writing, because he is kind of at the cornerstone of most everything that was written in that band. Right. And then next month, I've got some cool ones lined up that haven't quite got the dates lined down or nailed down yet, but I'm going to be chatting with Annie Haslam of Renaissance, Steve Rothery from Marillion, who else am I forgetting here? Leland Scar, you know, the famous session bass player.
Oh, sure. He's great player.
He played on Billy Cobham's Spectrum and hundreds of other sessions. Played a lot with Phil Collins a whole lot. And towards the end of the month, I'm going to chat with John Luke Ponte. So,
wow. Okay. He's a great player.
Yeah, we got some legends coming up in July. Oh,
okay. Fantastic. Yeah, I absolutely will.
All right.
I'm a big watcher.
It's always a pleasure, my friend. And I you know, come back anytime. You know, well, next time an interview comes out, let's have an interview.
And, you got it.
Go over the details. All right. And okay. Give my best to Noah. If you're watching this, Noah, it's always a pleasure. Yep. Thanks for making everything tick. All right, y'all. I'll be back this time next week. Same bat channel.
Okay. All right. Okay. Derek. See you later. Good night.